Okay, so any issues from last time?
Yeah, I have this verse 30. Could you just explain again? That liar is paper.
Yeah, Vyavritti iti Acharya. So we were talking of dhyana dharana abhyam dharana abhyasa vairagya adibhis tan nirodha. So we were talking of this chitta vritti nirodha by means of dhyana dharana etc. So now he says that by that this laya and vikshepa, they are destroyed. What are laya and vikshepa? Laya and vikshepa are the chitta vrittis only. Okay, so laya is nidra vritti and vikshepa is the other four vrittis, that is pramana, vikalpa, viparyaya and smriti.
So these are overridden by your chitta vritti. Does that mean?
Sorry?
So these two are overridden by when you get attained chitta vritti. Is that what it means?
Chitta vritti is the functioning of your mind. Vritti.
When you achieve to stop your mind, so these two states are that overrides this. Is that what it means?
No, these are the same. This is just a description of chitta vritti only by two different words. So laya and vikshepa are chitta vrittis only.
Okay, got it. Okay.
Uttara, I have a question. Why did they include even smriti in this? Isn't a smriti anyway required? It's like a database, right? So why have they said that even that is destroyed or destroyed kind of?
Destroyed in the sense only for that period. While you are in the samadhi avastha, you are not accessing your memory either. So original database which is sitting over there in a static form will continue. Okay. But the access of it, the input or the output are stopped.
Okay.
Yeah. The functioning only of the mind is stopped. But whatever storage is there, that remains. So once you come out of samadhi, you will be back to being a normal person. Okay. So if there are no more questions, then let us do a quick recap. So we have to start from 22, that is Adhikari Trayavidhyan Na Niyamaha. Who wants to take this up?
Can I do it?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. He is answering the question here, why different souls take different times to achieve moksha. So he explains that there are no rules to this and there's no fixed time period to attaining moksha. And it depends on how much honest effort each one puts in.
Correct.
And over and above that, God decides who is ready to reach the stage.
Right.
Just as he decides on your karma phalas.
Yeah.
And then we are also divided into three types of eligible people who are like high, medium and low, who are the higher souls are closer to attaining this. The medium is less close and the low is quite further away from this.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
So,
yeah, yeah. That's correct. So, Dadhyartham Uttaresham?
I can take that up.
Yeah, sure.
So, here he is saying the other two types like Uttama, Madhyama and Athama. Madhyama and Adhama are also mentioned because, you know, otherwise they would just, they also have, you know, one time they will also achieve the mukti. It is if they are not mentioned, then you know the encouragement that you know they are on the path, but they need to put more effort will not be there.
Correct.
So that is why also they are mentioned here.
Exactly. Exactly. So then next one, sthira sukham asanam iti na niyama. This is very easy. Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yeah, Kapila starts with C is for the moksha. Just make it because the sound is there. Okay. To get that moksha, and before that, the dhyana and samadhi, how we have to be, one has to have. So he says the posture, what he talked about, the posture. Mm. He says one should have a comfortable posture, not one should have to sit in Padmasana or something like that, as Patanjali has quoted. But whatever is comfortable to the each individual, that way he can have that posture and meditate upon whatever he wants to do. That's what he was mentioning about that. Kapila as well as Patanjali, they never give emphasis on the any asanas or anything, posture.
Yeah.
But normally they say Padmasana, you sit and meditate on. That's what about this is said.
Yeah, yeah.
About the posture.
Right. Then dhyanam nirvishayam manah.
Can I?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so here actually he's trying to define dhyanam by saying that, when the mind is not connected to the objects, or rather the mind is not attached, then, it is dhyana.
correct. Okay. Ubhayatha apya visheshas chen naivam uparaga nirodhat visheshah. Okay, that's a long one. Who's taking this?
No, not me, Uttaraji, because... sorry.
Okay.
Sorry, somebody else can take it up.
Sure, sure.
That'll be nice.
Can I try again?
Yeah, sure. Yep. Yeah.
So what we said is that the soul also does not have attachments, So then why are we're saying that soul is nisanga. So then why are we worried about doing dhyana actually?
Yeah, yeah.
Right? What's the need? So what is so special about dhyana? I answer that, then there'll be too many other things also, right? In the next... where he answers it in the next 2-3.
Na ched na evam uparaga nirodhat visheshah.
So the attachments or uparaga, the attachments are being stopped. That is why dhyana is important or it is special.
It is different, right? Yes. Yes.
Dhyana is different.
So is that clear? Is it clear the meaning?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, maybe you could put it for us together one second because I thought it was two different pieces of information.
No, ubhayatha abhi avisheshah chet. If you, if somebody says that the soul remains constant between the two, then why should you go into meditation? then you have to go into meditation, because in meditation you lose the attachments.
Okay.
Correct. That's true. Okay. Nisangi api upar ago avivekat.
Yeah, I'll take it up.
Yeah.
It says that though the mind and the soul, the soul and the body are completely different, they are not attached to each other.
Yeah.
Though the soul is unattached, there is uparaga because of ignorance, because of aviveka.
Yeah.
And so the thing is,
tell. Go ahead.
So, sorry. So then, because of because there is ignorance, because of ignorance, there is the uparaga. Mm-hmm. It says that the attachments that come from the body are mostly due to the delusions of the body. And that is the reason that though the soul is unattached, it is still because of the aviveka, if there is uparaga.
Yeah. Correct. Okay. So we will get more clarity in the next sutra, which is tapaskatikayoreva no uparagaha kintu abhimanaha. Who wants to take this up?
So here actually again the Purvapakshi kind of puts in a thing saying that, oh, isn't that like just like seeing through a transparent crystal, a colorful flower? Isn't that the way? There is no real attachment, something like that.
So, no paragaha kintu abhimanaha.
I cannot connect.
Here it is different because the ahankara or abhimana actually feels the soul, I mean, makes the soul feel as though it is enjoying everything, or it is feeling sad and it is, you know, going through that. So the attachment here is unlike that of a, you know, crystal in front of a flower, which takes on the hue. But here the attachment is, the signals are there. So the soul is actually in some ways experiencing everything that the body is.
Yeah, so that this analogy is good to a certain extent, yet it is not 100% true, because while the crystal remains completely untouched by the flower, in the case of the mind and the soul, the mind does have some impact on the soul, to the extent that the soul does experience those things itself. That experience, while it originates in the body, it is felt by the soul. So that is why it is that uparaga is felt in the soul itself. And that is how
That experience forms the layer in us, and that layer has becomes the abhiveka layer, no? The experience whatever experience we experience, that on the soul it becomes as a layer, and through the dhyana and the samadhi we are able to dispel, and slowly we get out from the layer one by one layer. That's what.
Yeah, so that soul, while it is formed on top of, the layer is formed on top of the soul. So the soul always remains pure per se.
Yeah.
It does not imbibe anything, but yes, this layer is formed on top of it. That is correct. Okay, so dhyana dharana abhyasa vairagyadipis tan nirodha.
You want me to take it?
Sure.
Okay. Again, he says that attachment can be removed, or the uparaga can be removed by dhyana and samadhi. Kapila does not talk about that, all the eightfold path which Yoga Darshana talks about, yama and asana, all this thing. He just takes the last three, that is a dharana, dhyana and samadhi.
Yes.
And these are the three things he takes it because others are not related to the Sankhya Darshana.
Yeah.
For rigorous, he says that for rigorous practice, we should concentrate on the dharana on a one particular object, and from there we need to go to the dhyana and samadhi. And plus he says the vairagya is also another point or issue which we must practice in our life to get that stage.
Correct.
That's
correct.
What talks about it.
It's for nirodha, that is chitta vritti nirodha. So then we come to laya vikshepayor vyavritti iti acharya.
Yeah.
So that we have covered anyway. Shall we skip it?
Yeah.
Sthana niyamash chitta prasadat. This is easy.
So here he says there is no particular place. This is where, in a prescribed place, where one should do the dhyanam or do the meditation. Correct. As long as they find themselves peaceful and comfortable, in that place is valid enough to be, you know, a place to do meditation.
Right. Okay. So now we'll move on to the next one.
In Laya Vikesh 30th one, there also he says, dhyana samadhi lives in the chitta vritti nirodha completely. At that time, the mind does not have any sort of thoughts or anything. Just still.
Yes.
And whereas mind has its own functions also, and that's what he given the function. There is a pramana, and then viparyaya, vikalpa, and nidra.
Yeah.
And sthiti. And nidra is the one where particularly in sound sleep, we don't have any thought or anything like that. We become very thoughtless. Chitta vritti completely becomes nirodha. Whereas in all other four, we do have the chitta vritti continues that. And that's what he was talking about, that the dhyana and samadhi is the where completely we have the chitta virodhi, which chitta vritti nirodha, which we need to practice continuously.
Yes. Okay. So the iti acharya, that is what the learned people, the wise people tell us. Okay. So now you can please mute your mics and we will start the lesson. प्रकृते राद्योपादानतान्येषां कार्यत्वश्रुतेः. So here now he moves on to, Kapila moves on to the upadana karan. You know, this is actually Sankhya's main subject, that what is the order of creation, and in that, how does the Purusha, the Jivatma fit in, and where does God fit in? That is the main subject of Sankhya. That is why he keeps returning to this Upadana Karana, etc. So he returns to this again and he says, Prakriteh Adyopadanata. Primordial matter is the initial Upadana Karana, efficient cause. Anyesham Karyatva Shute. Of all the others, it is the initial one, because all the others are said to be karyas of that, are effects of that primordial matter. Okay, so this is just, you can say, one assertion which he has already made earlier. Now he is making this assertion again, changing the topic so that he can also continue into the next one. A number of assertions are just for your... as we are saying, revision chapter. So one is for revision, one is for movement into another subject which he wants to discuss under this. So he just lays down this fact. Then he says, Nityatve api natmano yogyatva bhavat. So he says that even though the soul is nitya, it is not the upadana karan, because it doesn't have the necessary criteria by which it can be the upadan karan. Okay. So one is when we look at nityatva, why is he focusing on the nityatva of the soul? So first of all, here actually atma could refer to the soul or God, but he is in this case here it is taken as the soul. Okay, you could potentially take it as God as well. However, let us proceed with the meaning of soul. These two, both God and soul, are called atma because of one major commonality between the two, and that is of chetana, of animation. Both of them are conscious beings. So even though this soul, the individual soul, is also eternal, and to that extent the universe also be occupying a very long period of time and you know, is near eternal, it could potentially form the upadan karan of the universe. And that question could arise that why don't you consider the soul as the upadan karan? But it could not, because it is chetan, because it is animate. So this chetanta, you have to understand as something as lightness and light and darkness. So just as if there is light, there cannot be any darkness, and if there is darkness, there cannot be any light, because the two are opposite to each other. Similarly, animation and inanimation are two different things. They cannot coexist. So an animate being cannot be made inanimate elsewhere, and an inanimate thing cannot be made animate. This is the prime assertion which exists in our text. So that is why he said yogyatva abhavat, because it is not possible for the soul to make up this inanimate universe. Therefore, that assertion is not right. So given that these two statements, which have, by the way, been covered earlier, as you might remember, in the first chapter, we had already covered a lot of these. You can particularly look at sutras 139, 40, 41, 42. They were also linked. And otherwise also, we have done upadan discussion on the upadan karan. In fact, the homework for you is to do a correlation between these sutras. Okay, so remember, this is your homework. You have to correlate some of the sutras which we will be doing today with the earlier discussions. So now 34th sutra, he says, Shruti virodhan na kutarka pasadasya atmalabha. So he says that also this belief that the soul can form in some manner. For example, if we consider that Vedantic philosophy of Brahma only makes everything. So then firstly, it is against the Vedas. Shruti Virodha. Shruti Virodha exists. It is against the word which is coming down to us. And those who are existing in this kutarka, in this wrong logic, this fallacious assertion, those who are making, they are they will not be able to discover the soul. So this is actually a very, very potent argument for accepting this fact that there is God, there is the soul, and there is matter. What he's essentially saying is that if you live in this world thinking that this is also Brahma only, okay, then what is wrong in doing upasana with this only? And you will say, my body is also Brahma, so I need to treat my body also well. So all the desires of the body also, I have to meet them. because that is also Brahma. So Brahma wants good food, we will eat good food. Brahma wants to dress up well, we will dress it up properly. Brahma wants to put on lots of jewelry and do a lot of makeup, we will do that. So following that path, if you logically follow that path, then you cannot have Atmalabha. You will never find the soul. I think I have told you that story of Indra and Virochana. Remember from Chandogya Upanishad, where Indra and the king of the Devas and Virochana, who is the king of the Asuras, they go to Prajapati because they found they are told that Prajapati has discovered a way of getting rid of sorrows. And they go to him and Prajapati says that, look at your reflection. What do you see? They say that we see our body. So he said, that is the soul. So if you know about it, then you have reached the enlightenment. So Virochana is very happy and he goes. And so the Asuras, since that time, have believed in feeding the body with all that is available, comforts and food and clothing, etc. So they spend all their time in taking care of this body because they feel that this is my raison d'etre. This is actually the soul. So if we go with this wrong assertion, we will never find the soul. You will never look for it because this is Brahma. So why look for anything else? There's no reason to go anywhere else. So this is the biggest paradox which exists in that other philosophy which is there. And of course, they have built one whole big paraphernalia around it about one Ishwar which is there and the Upadhis which are there, etc., etc., just to explain this. But the long and short of it is actually that it is not correct. It is logically untenable. You cannot hold that belief and yet say that I am seeking my soul. And that is what is going to give me moksha. Because if this is Brahma, then where am I going to go with mukti? What am I getting rid of? I am that. So I'm not getting rid of anything because I am that. Okay, so that philosophy is very, very flawed and it is not acceptable. And now you can understand why the Vedantis are very, very against Siddha, Sankhya Darshanam, and the study of that has also gone down considerably. Okay, and this law.
Uttira?
Yes?
Does it not say the Shruti Virodhana? So the Shruti is the one which all the atheists believe in Shruti, and those who don't believe, that is not theist, we believe the Shruti, whereas the atheists, they don't believe in Shruti, no?
No. Shruti Virodat, because of Shruti Viroda, Kutarkapa Sadasya Na Atmalabha. Because this is against Shruti, because it is against the Shruti, so those who are seated in this belief, Kutarka Apasada, those who are seated, literally now I'm telling you, seated in this belief, in this wrong, flawed logic, for them there is no Atmalabha. Na Atmalabha. So Na has to be read later on when you do the Anvaya. Okay, so we will end this meeting here. And we will start the next one. Okay? Please connect with the same ideas.